Hello, I'm JW. This time we're going to have a look at multimeters, and mainly from an electrical point of view, so not specifically to do with electronics, as the types of functions you'll need on a multimeter are somewhat different. And we're going to have a look at the basics of what you can actually do with one, and also sort of things to look for if you're intending on purchasing one for electrical purposes. Now, a multimeter is simply a meter which measures multiple things, and in terms of modern ones, they have a whole range of functions, most of which are never used for electrical installations, and in fact quite a few of them are never used for anything. But the basic things that a multimeter can measure will apply to pretty much any multimeter you can buy. And the first thing it can measure is voltage. Voltage is measured in volts. And voltage is typically considered to be the sort of force or the amount of pressure that a particular thing is actually going to apply. And this is generally in the range of 240 volts if it's a main circuit, or say it might be say 12 volts or something for a battery. But say generally it's the amount of force or pressure that can be applied. The second thing is current. Current is measured in amps. And current is really the amount of electricity that's actually flowing in a circuit, or you could consider it like the quantity of electricity. Now, these two things are related, and we have seen these in a previous video. Basically, for any particular item, if you increase the voltage or increase the amount of force involved, then you're going to get more current flowing through that particular circuit. And conversely, if you reduce the voltage, then the current also reduces as well. And the property of a circuit to in terms of how much current will go through given a certain voltage is called the resistance. Resistance is measured in ohms, and essentially that's how difficult or easy it is to shove electricity through there. And again, we have looked at that in a previous video. So for any given resistance or fixed amount of sort of resistance in a circuit, if you increase the voltage, the current also increases. And if you have a fixed voltage, if the resistance is fairly low, it means a lot of current will flow through, and if the resistance is high, then a small amount of current will flow through. And we've seen this all related before, and say in the other video there, and it's basically the relationship that volts is equal to current in amps times the resistance. And that can be rearranged in various other ways, so you can have voltage divided by current equals the resistance, and of course various other combinations which we've seen previously. So voltage, current and resistance are the three basic things which any multimeter can measure, and of course are by far the most common things which are used. Now of course there are many other things which multimeters can measure, and it depends on the one you've actually purchased, but certainly these things will always be present. Some of the other functions are useful, most of them are not. So let's have a look at a typical multimeter and see what's actually on the front. So here we have a typical multimeter. This is a fairly old one that doesn't particularly matter. They're all basically the same in the operation. This one says British Telecom on it, but it's actually made by Beckman Industrial, a company which doesn't even make multimeters anymore, so it gives away how old that is. But certainly we've got a display at the top here, little power switch so we can turn the thing on, and in the middle here we've got the range switch which will basically select what we're measuring and also the appropriate range of the thing that we're measuring. Terminals at the bottom here, and that's where you connect the test leads which connect to whatever it is you're actually testing. Now this one, in common with pretty much all multimeters, has 4mm sockets, and 99% of test leads are also 4mm, so pretty much any test lead will fit with any multimeter, typically supplied as a red and black pair. These ones just have normal probes on the end, but again you get different attachments there for different situations. Now in terms of the sockets at the bottom here, this particular one has four. Some multimeters only have three, but generally the arrangement is pretty similar. Now the black lead that's supplied with it always goes in the common outlet here, and in this case it's actually coloured black, so that one we'll just shove in there. The red one normally goes in the socket marked volts and ohms, which is the way you would measure voltage and resistance, and in this case it's got a red circle on it as well, so generally that will be kept in there. The other sockets on this one are for current, and in this case we've actually got two, so this is for amps, which only goes up to a small amount of current, And then we've got a 10 amp one, which, as the name suggests, can be used for measuring up to 10 amps. If you wanted to measure current, then you would take the red lead out of here and then place it either in here or in there, depending on how much current you're intending to measure. Most measurements for main circuits particularly will never use the current ranges. It's pretty much only going to be voltage and resistance, hence you would normally keep the thing in there. If you do use these, then of course that's fine, but when you finish, take it out of here and put it back in here, because if you don't, then there's a fairly unfortunate occurrence which can happen, which we'll take a look at later on. Now in the centre here we've got the range switch, and this is just a rotary arrangement here, so it will just turn around, and then the actual point here is at the end. What we'll do is just put a bit of a mark in there so it's a bit easier to see on the video, so that's the bit we're actually pointing at. And if we have a look around the outside of this, we've got the various markings here. So at the moment we're in the amps range here, so the symbol A, and this symbol here is for AC, as isn't what will come out of your sort of wall outlet, so that's AC amps. If we come around to this part here, we've also got amps, but that's DC, and that's basically in line with the three dots. That's pretty much what it gets, say, from a battery or a computer power supply or something. Over here we have resistance, so we've got the ohms symbol there for all of that. And at the top here we've got voltage, and again we've got voltage DC, as from, say, a battery or something, and voltage AC, as in, say, from the wall outlets or the main supply. So this particular one only has those three basic things, although the voltage and current is divided up into AC and DC. Now, because this is a fairly old multimeter, this is what's called a manual range multimeter. So within each section, so say the volts AC here, we've got various different selections here, starting with, let's say, 750, 200, 22, and 200 M, or 200 milli. And essentially what this is the maximum for each of these, that the voltage that can be displayed. So if we set it to this one here, we can measure anything up to 750 volts. But if we set it to this one, it will only display anything up to 200 volts. And conversely, if we stuck it right down here, we could only display anything up to 2 volts. Now, the reason for having these things is if we go to the 750 range, you see that the display basically just has the three digits. So if we plugged in there, we would get sort of 750. And if we had a very low voltage, the lowest voltage we can display on here is going to be 1. Now, there's nothing wrong with that if you're measuring voltages in the hundreds, but if you're measuring, say, a voltage of, say, 1.5 volts on your battery, that is just displaying 1 isn't going to be very helpful. Now, if we turn down to the 200 range, so you've got now a little decimal point has appeared. So in this case, we could display anything up to 200, but we're going to get an extra digit of information. So if it's, say, 150 volts, we get 150, possibly 0.3. So although we're not measuring up to such a high level, we can actually get an extra decimal point there, so we've got sort of tenths of a volt. And so we go down the range, we go down to the 20 volt range, we now get 2 decimal points, so we have something like 8.23 volts. And again, we go down to the 2 volt range, again we can get sort of 1.234 volts. So as you're going down, you're basically getting more decimal points displayed, but the trade-off for that is you can only go up to a considerably lower value. And the 200 millivolt range, again, that's the decimal point here, but bearing in mind this is now a factor of 1,000 less, so although the point's here, so it couldn't be moving even further over there. Now, I notice this is drifting about a bit, that's because the leads here are not connected to anything, and on a very low range here, if you just move the leads around, then it can basically pick up all kinds of spurious information and display all kinds of garbage. But if you connect those two leads together, you'll see that will actually go down to 0, which is pretty much what you'd expect. And most multimeters have that issue. So just bearing in mind, if the leads are not connected, then all kinds of gubbins can be displayed on the display, particularly at the very low ranges, say the 200 millivolts. So when actually selecting the range manually, the thing to do is to select a voltage, say, that's higher than what you're expecting to measure. So if you're going to, say, measure the mains voltage in the UK, it's going to be typically in the range of 240. You would need to select the 750 volts because all of the others are lower than that. But say you're going to measure a battery, a 9-volt battery, you would select, say, the 20-volt range, because although the 200 and 750 are more, you're going to be losing out on those decimal points, whereas the 20, of course, is more than 9. You wouldn't use the 2 because 2, of course, is much less than 9, so obviously that's not going to work correctly. So let's actually measure something. Here we've got a battery, This is just one of these 9-volt batteries here with the two terminals on the top there. And for this one, again, we're going to be using the voltage, but we're going to use voltage DC because, bearing in mind, it's a battery, there's no AC coming out of that. And we're going to turn the range switch, in this case, to the 20-volt range there. Because, again, 9 volts falls below 20, but obviously 2 would be no good because that's far too low. So we'll just switch on there. Now, the deal with certainly DC volts is that the black one is generally representing the negative terminal, and the red one is the positive. And we have a look on this battery, it is actually marked on the side here, negative and positive over there. So we'll put the black one on the negative terminal and the red on the positive. And then we should see the voltage there, 9.4 volts. Now that's actually a bit more than 9 because this is a brand new battery, never been used. And the other thing, there's no load attached to this. So basically we're just checking the essentially open circuit voltage. If we attach a load to this, then the voltage will be somewhat lower. So simply place the probes there, it gives you the voltage. Now in that case, because we're putting the probes on what would be considered the correct terminals, black to negative, then the display is just showing us the actual voltage. If we didn't know which one was which, and we say connected them the wrong way round, we still get the same reading in the display, but there's no sense there's now a minus symbol before it there, so that sort of negative bit there. And that indicates that the red probe is actually on the negative terminal. So it still gives us the correct reading, say 9.4, but it's just telling us that the polarity of that is actually reversed. So if there's no display here, the red one is positive with respect to the black one, and if there is a negative there, then it means the red one is negative with respect to the black one. Now for AC voltage, it's pretty much the same deal. Again, you just select the appropriate range and the two probes would obviously place onto the terminals or whatever it is you're measuring. Bearing in mind, there's no polarity with the AC volts because it's changing polarity all the time, so we just get the actual numbers displayed. The negative symbol does not apply for AC volts. Now this multimeter, say, is quite an old one, and it has this sort of manual ranging thing, which can be useful in some situations, but the majority of new multimeters have what's called auto-ranging, and have a look at this example here. Got the same kind of things around the edge here, so volts here, and ohms, and amps, and so on. But you notice that there's no actual additional information here, so if we just turned it, say, to voltage AC, then that's all we've got. And what will happen is that the meter will actually change the range automatically for you. So in this case, it's just a question of selecting the appropriate function, sticking the probes onto whatever voltage you've got, and then this will select the most appropriate range automatically. Now, although this is obviously a much newer meter and fairly different design, at the bottom here we've got the same basic terminals, so the common one in the middle, which is black, where the black lead goes, and then the red one would normally go in the volts and ohms terminal here, and if we wanted to measure current, then we would just move it over to that one for current measurements only. And if we turn to, say, DC volts here, we can do the same thing we had with that battery that we did previously. And again, it's just placing them onto the relevant terminals there. And this should change automatically to give us the most useful range. So there we go, 9.41 volts. And that's how it automatically changed that to the most sensible choice. The only disadvantage with auto ranges is that there is a slight delay in it changing to the correct range. This one happens to be fairly fast. Some, of course, are considerably slower, so that's something to bear in mind, that once you connect, there is a bit of a delay there while it sorts out which one you want. And if we do the sort of reverse thing again, it's the same deal, it will just display a negative in front of the number. And you see, just as with the other one, if we open the circuit there, just leave these flapping, and just flap around with the wires, then all kinds of random junk appears on the display. And if we place them together, then of course it shows zero, as you would expect. Now the final point about voltage, particularly with things like batteries, is that when it's on a normal range here, as in the sort of volts here, volts there, or in the case of this meter, any of those voltage choices, what's actually inside the meter between the two terminals is effectively a 10 mega ohm resistor, so a very high resistance. So when you connect the wires to a power source, such as a battery, virtually no current is actually flowing. And that's why this 9-volt battery actually shows considerably higher than 9 volts, because again, you're not putting any load on this. It's purely the sort of open circuit voltage, which is always higher than if there's something connected. Now, this particular meter, and quite a lot of others, have another feature over here for volts, which says low Z, or low impedance. This will still measure volts, and the difference being that instead of having a 10 mega ohm resistor in here, it has a much lower resistance, typically in order of, say, 100k, or in some cases, considerably less. And this actually puts a moderate load on the battery or circuit or whatever you've got, and that can give a more realistic reading, particularly if you've got, say, very long wires in a building, or in the case of this battery, a battery that's actually a bit busted and not really suitable for use. So if you measure this, what is supposed to be a 12-volt battery with the normal voltage range there, let's just see what we get. So we'll just attach the things to the end here. Now this battery is bust, which is why I've particularly chosen it. So if we attach there, open circuit voltage is 8.72 volts. Now that's pretty poor for a 12-volt battery, but I think, well, it's not too horrendous. And you see that voltage is pretty stable, nothing really changing there. But bearing in mind that was with absolutely no load on it, so now if we change to the other setting, which again will do volts, but it will actually apply a moderate load to the battery, we can see what we get. So in this case we only get 7, and you'll see it's actually dropping away quite rapidly because we're, say, applying a moderate load, so it's already down to 6.2, 6.1, 6, and it's still falling. So this gives you a much more realistic option of what would happen if this was put in a piece of equipment. Basically, it's just not going to work. Voltage is going to just drop away to a stone, and it's simply not going to function. And again, if we go back to the other high impedance range, and you'll see the voltage is now actually increasing, as essentially the battery inside or the chemistry is actually recovering somewhat, coming back up to that higher voltage we had before. So quite a useful feature there with the lower impedance input, and certainly things like batteries, it gives you a more realistic indication of the condition of the battery. Here's this one completely ruined. So that's voltage. General case is taking the two probes, placing onto the item in question, and seeing what you've got. And again, that's all we've done on the volts and ohms terminal over here. And speaking of ohms, the next thing, of course, is resistance, which on this meter is just over here. So if we just rotate it around to there, then it's the same probes, the same terminals, and again, you're placing these across some device. Now, the important thing with measuring resistance is it's always done with the power disconnected. So if it was a mains circuit, you're going to be disconnecting the mains completely. You're not going to be measuring the resistance of a battery because that's simply not going to work. So it's only for circuits which are disconnected, not powered, and there's no electricity anywhere near it. Now, in the current state here, because the probes here are not connected to anything, we've actually got OL on the display, which in this case stands for over limit. And it basically means that the resistance here is so high, it can't actually be displayed. Now, if we connect these two together, we should get zero, or pretty much as zero as we can get. In this case, 0.1, which is going to be basically just the resistance of these test leads. So it's open circuit or over limit, or basically short circuit, extremely small resistance. And for electrical circuits, that's basically the only two things you're going to look for. So wiring in your house, for example, you will either expect to see completely open or shorted together with a very low resistance. Now, of course, you can measure resistances within the range of between those. So here actually is a resistor, as we used in electronic devices. And if you've got one of those, it's again just a question of placing it between those and measuring that this is in fact a 33 ohm resistor, or 33.4 there. But in terms of electrical circuits, in terms of your house or wiring or whatever, you would not expect to find moderate resistances within the wiring of your house. So it's either going to be completely open or extremely low. Certainly if you tested a wiring house and found it was 33 ohms, then something has gone horribly wrong. But nevertheless, you can obviously use it to measure things, resistances of, say, water heaters and that type of thing. Now, this particular meter and motor does have an additional feature for resistance, which is this one. Display is exactly the same. The only difference is at lower resistances, it makes a beeping noise, which is more sort of a useful indicator, particularly for wiring, because if it's open circuit, there's no noise. If they're connected, then there is a noise. So it's quite a useful feature there. This meter also has a similar thing, and again, it's just a question of selecting the range there with the little speaker on it. That only goes up to 200 ohms. And in the case of this one, it's a similar sort of figure. but certainly resistance, it's just a question of sticking it on the two things. But when the power is disconnected, if you attempt to get a battery and think, oh, let's measure the resistance of this, then what actually happens is nothing at all. And if we start the other way around, nothing at all. So, of course, that's completely wrong because all batteries have some kind of internal resistance. On this meter, it shows nothing at all. On this one, it could do something different. In others, it could even damage the meter completely, particularly if you, say, stuck this into a mains outlet and attempted to measure the resistance. This particular one won't be damaged. This would probably blow up in a ball of flames, and some cheap thing from some imported place almost certainly would blow up in flames as well. So, resistance, no power there, always disconnected. Now for current measurements, as in the amount of amps flowing through a circuit, again we've got AC and DC here, just as on the older one there. And the difference with these is you need to remove the wire from the volts and ohms terminal and place it into the amps terminal. Now for mains voltage circuits, it's desperately unlikely that you're ever going to measure the current using a device like this with two probes. Now for any kind of circuit you want to measure current, you do need to actually break into the circuit and connect the meter in series with it. So if you had, say, a battery here, and then we had, say, a lamp or something there, to actually measure the current flowing in the circuit, what you would have to do is to cut one of the wires and then redivert this wire here and this one over here, and then you connect your meter between these two points. So what's actually happening then is the current is flowing through the meter, through whatever load it is you've got, and then returning to the battery. Now this is all very well with something, say, like a 9-volt battery, which we saw previously, but if this was a mains voltage circuit, then you've got to basically turn off the entire circuit, hack bits out of it, somehow shoehorn in your multimeter leads, and bearing in mind you wouldn't be using pointy probes like this because you've got to basically connect them permanently in some fashion, and then turn on the power. All of the power then goes through the meter, and all the current goes through the meter, and then you can read off how much current is going through there. Not a particularly likely scenario, and bearing in mind if that was 240 volts, then obviously there is a certain amount of danger involved. So although you can measure current with these things on main circuits, it's pretty much something that's never done, simply because it's too inconvenient and it's quite dangerous. Now another hint of danger here is that because the current has to actually flow through the meter, what's inside the meter in this case is essentially a piece of solid wire. Unlike when we use, say, the voltage and the resistance ranges, what was inside the meter was effectively a very high resistance. We've now effectively got a short circuit, so with the probes in these positions in the current hole, there's basically a solid link between those two inside, which has a very small resistance in the orders of a fraction of an ohm. So if you left this here by mistake and then thought, oh, let's go and measure some voltage and place this across some piece of equipment, you're basically shorting out whatever that piece of equipment is. And if that was the mains, the result is there's a huge explosion, the leads disintegrate and turn to molten copper, and the meter is a flaming fireball. So that's why you always remove it from here and put it back here. Because if you just do something wrong with these, probably nothing's going to get damaged. But if you put it in there and measure across the voltage, then basically something is definitely going to get damaged. So although you can measure current, certainly for mains voltage things, say it's ridiculously unlikely, not something you're likely to be doing. The usual way to measure current on AC circuits is to use a clamp meter, and this basically just clamps around one of the wires, so you don't have to break into it or expose any live parts. And we've seen clamp meters in various other videos previously. Now, if you're going to go and buy one for mains voltage or that kind of use, there are certain things you need to look for, and particularly on new ones, that one to look for is this rating here, which is also the maximum voltage, and also this CAT rating, which is either going to be 1, 2, 3 or 4. Certainly for mains voltage, you want to be looking at something at least category 2 as a really bare minimum, and that would only apply if you're measuring in, say, a situation like on a bench or something. If you're going to do anything in your house, you really want a CAT 3. And certainly for any kind of industrial or other locations, even a CAT 4 may be required. And this particular rating as well as saying the maximum voltage it can be used up to. The 1, 2, 3 and 4 is representing how much fault current, or how much energy effectively, can the thing deal with if something catastrophic goes wrong. So like, for example, earlier, if you'd taken your wires and some idiot had just left it in the wrong hole here, and then you went and just poked these into an outlet, there's going to be a massive amount of current flows through these in the order of hundreds or even thousands of amps for a short time. In the case of this one, then, it should be able to withstand that. I mean, it may be damaged and destroyed, but the point is, you won't be. The explosion should be contained within the device. So certainly for mains voltages, you do need to make sure it is appropriately rated. Now, this is an older one, which was done before these cat ratings were really something that was put on them. You notice there's no actual markings here of any kind, and therefore this is not really suitable for mains voltage use, although of course you could do it use at your own risk. So it's not just the voltage it goes up to, it's whether it can withstand any kind of massive power surge or whatever in the event of you connecting it wrongly, or even if it was connected correctly and then there was some massive surge on the line due to a fault elsewhere, so lightning strikes a transformer down the street, or your neighbour decides to drive their car into the pole with the transformer on it and it falls to the ground in a sparking, arcing mess. Now, multimeters suitable for mains use will have inside some fairly substantial sized fuses, so that if you are an idiot and connect it wrongly and short it out, the fuse inside will disconnect the circuit and prevent a dangerous explosion. So we'll have a look inside this one to see what it's got. So we can get the covering off of there. So this is a decent one. Decent ones also cost more nevertheless, but they would, wouldn't they? So we'll just open this one up in here and see what we can find. This has batteries in it, of course. Now, I wouldn't normally open these just to have a look. Generally, you're going to open it up when something has gone horribly wrong. This one isn't ideal in the fact that the battery one you can easily open. Anything to do with fuses and whatever, though, you can't. Nice threaded insert for the battery holder, but basically it's just mashing into the plastic there with the other kind. But nevertheless, so you wouldn't normally be opening this to replace fuses unless you're the most careless person in the world. Right, so there we have it. So inside here, you can see we've got at the bottom here this massive fuse there, and this is the one which would at least protect you from complete damage in the event you were connecting it incorrectly or shorting out something that you shouldn't. So this is what's inside here. This is the common terminal, and then this is the one for current or amps. And this little loop of wire here is what's basically between those two when you're making a measurement. So if you connect that across the mains, all of the mains power is going to go through that little loop of wire and cause a huge explosion. Although in the case of this one, it won't, because also in series with that is this large fuse here. So this fuse will then blow and disconnect the huge amount of energy that's coming through. And we can actually see on this one that it's rated to 1000 volts AC or DC. And this is important because a lot of fuses are only rated to AC. The capabilities for breaking DC are considerably more arduous, so it is important to have one that's rated DC. And as we see here, this one has an additional rating of 20 kA or 20,000 amps. So if you connect it across the mains, you're going to get several thousand amps flowing, as long as it's less than 20,000, which it most definitely would be in a, say, a normal situation. This fuse is capable of disconnecting that kind of fault. Of course, if that's blown, there's no guarantee you can just pop it open and replace it, but the point is that even if the meter might be severely damaged, the person holding it won't be. Other things on this meter we can see are the edge here has this significantly deep groove here. And if you look on the other half of the case, there's a very large piece that goes in there. So if there was some kind of explosion inside due to shorting out the mains or whatever, then it would be contained within the actual casing and wouldn't have sort of flames and smoke billowing out of the sides. And so it goes all the way around the entire thing there. And have a look over this side. We've got this big piece of plastic here and another piece here. And these actually come through slots in the circuit board. And it's just to divide off different areas so that in the event of a fault here, it's just stopped from going across to other areas. So you've got your two terminals there, fuse here, and it's obviously basically pulling a shield between here and this side, and say another piece over here. Now, so this one is quite a bit older and doesn't have any of those cat ratings, but this isn't really designed for mains use. But, let's see what we've got inside. Not sure the age of this one, although it said 85, which might indicate 1985. Battery for this one is in here. Same kind of 9 volt thing. I can actually get the thing out of there. And it has one of these horrible snap things on the top, which better newer meters don't generally have. Straight away we can see here there's a fuse, but it's some tiny little glass thing. Put 20,000 amps through there, it's just going to be a vaporised mess instantly. So let's see what we have inside. Now, first thing to notice is the case here has a bit of a lip on it, but it's massively smaller than on the Fluke one there. So if there was an explosion inside, there's a good possibility of it coming out along the sides or even via the battery compartment, which just clips in there. Now in here, I don't know if we can actually remove this possibly without unscrewing. Yes, perhaps just to undo a screw there. Now this piece is just basically shielding to basically screen that from interference. And if you have a look underneath, the only fuse we have is literally just this one. And again, there's no slots in the circuit board or any sort of shielding protection or anything else. It's simply the circuit board. Terminals on the front here basically go straight through onto the circuit board. And you'll see that the distance between these, certainly on the tracks or whatever, is incredibly small. So if you connect it to those two, and basically short it out, then the voltage is going to be sufficient that it's going to easily be able to arc between the various parts inside and essentially destroy everything in there. So there's nothing to absorb the energy, and certainly shoving it across the mains, yes, in theory it would blow the fuse, but it's also likely to, say, arc across in various bits, cause things to be destroyed, blown apart, or set on fire. Now we should be able to lift this out. So as you can see there, it's just simply a terminal to directly onto the board. There's the basically the current shunt, or what's used to measure the current ranges. And as you can see, if we see the front current there between the common here and the 10 amp socket, which is basically this one and this one, there's basically a solid bar of copper or some other metal. So those two are basically shorted out. And you'll see there's no fuse in that circuit whatsoever. So you connect those across the mains, then all of the power is going to go through this. The track's going to be vaporised, that's going to blow apart. The whole thing is going to be severely destroyed. And it seems that the fuse in this case is actually just between the smaller current socket here, which is one only going up to, say, 2 amps. So in the case of attaching it to those, then the fuse would blow and you might be okay. But if you connect it to these two on the 10 amp range, then there's no fuse. You're definitely not going to be okay. And although there may be a few other components in here, there's no way any of those are going to save you from a direct short at mains voltage. So although you can measure voltage with these, bear in mind they're not really designed for that. And certainly this one, say 86 there, so that's presumably the manufacturing date of that. So 30 odd years old. But say at the time they were all made like that, so that's not necessarily a fault of that particular design. Well, they still work after taking them apart and putting that together, so I suppose that's something. And the final point about this, well, if you've got a category 3 meter, then it's also important that the leads themselves also have the same rating. These ones do have a rating printed on them. Actually up here, these are actually only category 2. There are some covers which are over the top which increase the rating to the next level. So if sort of having a category 3 meter, but do remember the leads have to be rated to the same or above, otherwise you're not really achieving a great deal. And again, leads can be had in all kinds of styles, types and price ranges. Now the two things, voltage and resistance, are by far the most commonly used things for certainly electrical installations. Say current you theoretically could use, but in reality not going to be happening. And most of these multimeters have a whole load of other functions on here, which we'll just have a quick look at. Now, if you're going to go and buy a multimeter, if it is for electrical installations, then it's going to be a somewhat different meter than if you're going to buy one for electronics. This particular one is designed for electrical work. And you'll notice on here that although it does have current, it doesn't have any milliamps or microamps range, so this would not be particularly applicable for electronics, because in that case you probably will be measuring current, but say it's not something you'd normally measure on an electrical mains voltage installation. So if you're going to be buying one, do bear in mind what kind of ranges and things it has, because one like this, say, is not desperately useful for electronics, as you don't have any low current ranges. Now, obviously this one, say, you've got some extra features here which are printed in the yellow, and let's just have a look at some of those and how useless they actually are. Now, most multimeters have other functions on them, and so we've got a few around the sides here, but most of them aren't actually that useful. One of which is frequency. Frequency is measured in hertz, used to be called cycles per second, and for certainly main circuits in the UK and Europe, that would be 50 hertz, and if you're in North America, then it would be 60. Now, there you can just measure that, and it's done with the same connections here, the common and the volts, ohms and everything else terminals. Remember, that's only for current use and is probably never used. But yeah, you can go measure it, but it's going to say 50, or it's going to say 60, or it might say, for example, 50.01 or something like that, or maybe even 49.94. But the reality is it's never going to be much away from 50, and if it does get away from 50 by even 1 hertz, then the reality is that the entire power grid is going to start to go wrong, and systems are going to be shutting down, and power stations are going to be tripping out, and all kinds of other stuff. Widespread blackouts, the whole country doesn't have any power anymore. So it's one of those things that it's either going to be correct, or the entire power system in the UK is bust. So realistically, you're not going to be needing to measure it, purely a novelty item. Perhaps if it was, say, a variable frequency drive and you wanted to check the output, but again, that's fairly unlikely because most of those can display the frequency on the front anyhow. And again, if it was completely way off, then the motor or whatever it's driving wouldn't be working. So yes, you can measure it, but probably not going to bother. Most multimeters have a capacitance function, and some may even have inductance as well. Capacitance used for measuring capacitors, and inductance for measuring inductors, as in coils of wire or windings of motors and the like. Now, again, you can measure these devices, so say a motor had a capacitor on it for starting purposes, you could take that off and measure it, see if it was within the expected value. But again, it's fairly unuseful because if you've got a motor and a capacitor on it and the motor doesn't work, then it's fairly likely the capacitor is bust. So in most cases, you just get a new capacitor and stick it on there, much quicker than trying to measure the capacitance of something that's stuck on the side of it. And again, you could measure, say, the inductance of a motor or something, but not very useful because it's not going to really tell you anything. And of course, that also assumes you knew what it should be in the first place. So may have those things, but not very useful. If it does, then capacitance is measured in farads, or more usually things like microfarads or picofarads. Inductance is measured in henries, and again, usually sort of millihenries or microhenries or whatever. So yes, it's got them, maybe of use for electronic things, but for main circuits, probably never used. Something else which most meters have is a diode check function. This particular one has it down here, it's this white symbol at the bottom here. A diode is basically a one-way deal for electricity, typically has a symbol like that. And the idea is that electricity can flow through in one direction, but is blocked when it tries to go in the other direction. Most commonly used for changing AC into DC. And you can check these things, just place the two leads on the ends. It should show as a reading in one direction, which is basically the voltage across the thing when it's powered, and if you put the other around, it should show nothing at all. But again, for an electrical circuit, say in your house or whatever, it's not going to contain diodes, so not particularly useful. Some equipment has those in, but again, that's more of an electronics type of thing, so not particularly useful for main circuits. Nevertheless, a lot of multimeters do have them, and in fact, even this old one here does actually have a function down here as a little symbol there, same as on the other one, so it's quite a common feature, but probably not going to use it. And the final item which some meters have is the transistor check or test or whatever. Now this is usually shown on the front panel of the meter, so you've got your meter here and it'll be some cheap thing from China or wherever, and it will have on the front, as well as the usual test holes, it will have probably up here a round deal with three metal contacts inside, and there'll be a switch on there to select that function. What you're supposed to do is to take your transistor, which is a three-prong electronic component, similar to two diodes in the same container, shove it in these holes, select the probe function, and then it tells you the gain of the transistor. However, this is completely useless because the very presence of these metal contacts on the front means that it cannot have a CAT rating of any kind, because of course bare metal on the front, some kind of fault occurs, then that's exactly where the explosion is going to come out. And of course you could touch those and get a shock from it while have your probes on a main circuit or something. So no decent meter will have a transistor tester. And the other point as well is that no one in the history of ever has required a need to actually check the gain of a transistor, which is basically all it tells you. And the transistor can be used as an amplifier. These things tell you how much it amplifies by, but the reality is that's never used, even in electronics, because circuits are not designed to have a transistor of a specific gain, because even transistors from the exact same batch vary massively. And any circuit that is designed to have a transistor of a specific gain is a pile of junk, and therefore isn't going to work properly anyhow. So anything with a transistor check on it is junk, and should never buy. And I mean, don't buy for any purpose, especially not mains use, and even for electronics use, it's junk anyhow, so you can do way better. These are typically the ones you can buy on eBay for sort of $2 or something, which gives you the idea of the quality, and that's $2 shipped to your house. So basically they're giving it away for free, just charging you the delivery. So that's multimeters. And bearing in mind that, say, for electrical circuits, things in your house or whatever, then really it is only the most basic functions that you actually need. All those other things on there which are usually included are actually not required. Let's say some of those may be useful for electronic purposes, but say for main voltage stuff, things like capacitance and checking diodes and whatever is rarely or probably never used. And certainly if you're going to be buying one to use on main voltage stuff, it is important that it is suitably rated for that. As obviously if you make a mistake or there's a surge or something outside, then you want the thing to actually remain in one piece and not set on fire or explode. Now in future videos, have a look at actually using a multimeter to test out various things in a property. But until next time, thanks for watching.